We'll be starting in about 1 minute. Good morning. The joint hearing on the Assembly Natural Resources and the Environmental Safety and Toxics Material is called to order. Welcome to the Joint Committee on Joint Hearing on California's Electronic Waste Programs. I'm the Chairman of the Environmental Safety Committee, and Mr. Chesbrough, to my right, is the Chairman of the Assembly's Natural Resource Committee. I apologize. I have some allergies in my voices. Grovelly, but I really don't always sound like Vito Corleone, so we'll get through here. I'm especially honored to be here jointly chairing this hearing with Assemblymember Chesbrough. He's been leading voice in recycling in the California legislature. The Natural Resources Committee and the Environmental Safety Committee share the responsibility and jurisdiction for e-waste legislation. Electronic waste is a complex mix of solid waste, toxic chemicals, and hazardous waste statutes and regulations. Hopefully today, we can educate the members of the committee on thorny issues of e-waste regulation and policy. We are very lucky to have exceptional witnesses from a wide range of industry involved in electronics. I'm looking forward to learning about the business here in California and worldwide. I'd like to acknowledge my colleagues who are also here, Shannon Grove and Assemblymember Bill Mani. Recently, the Vice Chair of the Resources Committee, Assemblyman Knight, who's on his way from the airport, and I were able to tour the Sims Corporation recycling facility in Roseville. That was a great introduction on how those electronics that fill our homes are processed towards recycling. One of the things we have already learned is that e-waste market is international. One of the critical issues for these committees is whether California is carrying out its responsibility to ensure that materials coming from our state are being handled properly, both in California and in the international market. The issues I've asked witnesses to address today include the following. First, how do we manage our e-waste overseas? How do recyclers and manufacturers deal with maintaining high environmental standards for their e-waste in the international market? Second, we have a complex regulatory system in California. The question we ask is whether multiple state agencies both manage and regulate the hazardous elements of e-waste. And finally, we need ideas and suggestions on the future of our e-waste program. Should California covered e-waste system be expanded to include a wider range of electronic products? The hearing today is part of the Assembly's oversight responsibility. That is to make sure that existing programs and laws are working and producing the most efficient regulations possible. This hearing is an opportunity for members of the public to share their views and offer suggestions on e-waste. We will have time at the conclusion of the hearing for additional public testimony, but we ask that those who wish to testify at the end of the hearing please limit your comments to 2 to 3 minutes. At this time, I'd like to turn the hearing over to Chairman Chesbrough for some introduction remarks. Mine's working.
I've been around here for years and I still have the same problem, so don't feel bad. I can never figure it out. Thank you, Chair Wachowski. E-waste is our one of our most important and one of our most successful recycling programs in California. In many ways, many respects, we can be proud of the work that's been done by the legislature, by CalRecycles, formerly known as the Integrated Waste Management Board, as well as, of course, the industry that has worked to put the infrastructure in place. Given the explosion in consumer electronics, this program is an absolutely essential component in our resource recovery economy and for the environment. That being said, I learned a long time ago from my own personal experience in the recycling world that collection is not recycling. And that's, you know, the public, the news media, everybody focuses on collection, and collection's obviously very important, but it alone does not constitute recycling. The materials we collect must find a home that is environmentally and economically sound and sustainable. Otherwise, we're simply exporting the problems that our consumer society creates, out of sight, out of mind. I look forward to hearing today how California is doing, both in the collection and take back of e-waste, and in the making sure that the materials we are collecting are reused or recycled in an environmentally sound fashion. We have an obligation to make sure that the cycle, in fact, is completed and that we don't have unintended consequences along the way. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Well, let's get started. Our first panel is the state agencies that are in charge of recycling and the regulatory, the Department of Resources, Recycling and Recovery, and the Department of Toxic Substances. So please come forward. We have Mr. Jeff Hunts. From the Electronic Waste Recycling Program, Carl Palmer with Pollution Prevention Program, and Sue Laney with the Enforcement and Emergency Response Program. Thank you very much for coming. I did receive from Mr. Hunts some props that I'll share with the members of the committee. These are panels from the television monitors that have been processed and made safe. And we have the funnel, which is the back end of the TV monitor, which we have here. So, Mr. Hunts, welcome. Go ahead, please.
Mr. Chairman, I thought maybe you were just bringing your mid-morning snack with you. No.
Thank you. Good morning, Chairs Wachowski and Chesbrough and committee members. My name is Jeff Hunts. I'm the manager of CalRecycles Electronic Waste Recycling Program, and I've been involved with my department's efforts and responsibilities related to e-waste for about the past decade. My goal for this morning is to provide this committee with a general background on the origin and implementation of California's Electronic Waste Recycling Act, a progress report on what has been achieved, an update on the challenges we've faced along the way, and a look ahead at market and operational concerns that will need to be discussed and addressed in the very near future. But let's first travel back to early 2001, when my colleagues at the Department of Toxic Substances Control were asked a direct question. Are cathode ray tubes, or CRT devices, hazardous when disposed? And the answer that they gave was yes. And this effectively banned old televisions and computer monitors from municipal landfill disposal. But it also saddled local governments with the burden of cleaning up and diverting cathode ray tubes and cleaning up illegally dumped monitors and cathode ray tubes left by those who were unwilling to bear the cost of proper recycling. Over the next 2+ years, as DTSC worked on universal waste regulations to ease the management of all hazardous electronics for the purposes of recycling, the state of California as a whole participated in a multi-stakeholder dialogue called the National Electronic Product Stewardship Initiative, or NEPSI. This effort, comprised of manufacturers, environmental interests, and state and local governments, was attempting to find a comprehensive e-waste solution. Both what was then the Integrated Waste Management Board and DTSC represented California at NEPSI. But NEPSI wore on without consensus, and local government costs mounted. And if there were a few bills to enact producer responsibilities here in California, but those stalled. So in 2003, California chose to go first and go it alone by enacting the Electronic Waste Recycling Act. The act established a state-administered payment system to foster a collection and recycling infrastructure and to remove the economic barriers to the proper management of old video devices, all funded through a consumer fee assessed on the retail purchases of new covered devices. The act, as amended, created this program to be co-administered by the Waste Board, now CalRecycle, and DTSC. DTSC regulates the physical management of all electronic waste, including covered electronic waste, and my colleagues will detail their responsibilities momentarily. CalRecycle was given the task of administering the financial aspects of the program, managing the participation of collectors and recyclers, deciding who gets paid or not, calculating payment rates, and determining fee levels. In the 15 months between the signing of the act and the beginning of the program, CalRecycle and DTSC worked closely on regulatory issues, ensuring alignment and avoiding overlap. We held what seemed to be dozens of stakeholder workshops, and we worked to craft rules to protect the environment as well as the integrity of public funds, to ease burdens on local governments, and to encourage innovation and efficiency in how waste was recovered and recycled. I believe you should all have a handout that looks like this. On the back, it has a simplified flow chart of how the covered electronic waste recycling program works. And on page 5, second to last page, there is a graphical depiction of the history of the program and the volumes that have flowed through the program. Beginning operation in January 2005, the covered electronic waste recycling program grew steadily for about 3.5 years. It recycled approximately 4 million additional pounds with each quarter. Admittedly, there were administrative hiccups along the way as workload occasionally outpaced staffing resources and when initial fund surpluses threatened to become insolvency problems. In the summer of 2008, the then Integrated Waste Management Board acted on two key components of the program. First, the recovery and recycling payment rates were reduced, and this was based on an ongoing analysis of industry costs. Payment rates are intended to cover the average net cost of collection and recycling, and this adjustment can be made every 2 years under current statute. The second action taken by the Waste Board in 2008 increased the consumer fee that is assessed on the sale of new products. This action was based on a projection of future funding needs using historical program growth and the new payment rates. And under current statute, the fee adjustments can be made annually to ensure solvency. Quarterly program volume spiked to a high of 62 million pounds in the first quarter of 2009, and this was likely a reflection of technology turnover resulting from the switch to digital broadcast television. Volumes then began to settle back into about the mid 40 million pound range, as stockpiled and easily recovered waste was exhausted and the economy as a whole slowed. In October 2009, we were notified by USEPA that all acknowledgments of consent to export glass to Mexico had been rescinded. Now, an acknowledgment of consent, or an AOC, is the allowance that an exporter must secure under the federal CRT rule before sending unprocessed CRT glass to a foreign destination. Because recyclers must ship CRT glass derived from processed covered electronic waste prior to submitting a payment claim to the state, and because Mexican facilities had been a preferred market, this action by the USEPA caused a significant disruption in the ability of recyclers to file claims. And this is reflected on the chart before you, beginning in the fourth quarter of 2009, where volumes dramatically fell off. Now, if there is any upside to this situation, it was that a few California recyclers took the initiative then to develop their own glass processing capabilities within the state, securing more control over their claim submittal and theoretically producing more marketable products. But that silver lining has threatened to become a dark cloud due to the changing global marketplace for CRT glass, and I'll address that in a moment. Currently, the industry as a whole has been slowly rebounding from the glass disruption, and recycling opportunities for the public remain abundant. Additionally, CalRecycle acted last year to lower the consumer fee in an effort to reduce excess fund reserves while maintaining the recycling and recovery payment rates at the same level. The net result of the first 6 years of California's e-waste experiment has been the recycling of nearly 1 billion pounds of unwanted televisions and computer monitors. There are currently about 60 recyclers, approved recyclers, supplied by about 600 approved collectors, and this is all augmented by a network of handlers and transporters throughout the state. Approximately $400 million have been paid to the collection and recycling infrastructure, creating and sustaining jobs here in California, and providing assurance that this waste was processed into commodities in-state before entering a global marketplace. Now, I'd like to address two issues that have received some media attention over the past year, and that would be the topics of fraud and export. As I just noted, a substantial amount of money flows through this program. CalRecycle must balance the intent of the program, which is to pay for the collection and recycling provided to the public, and to ensure that only compliant operations receive public funding. Through its very conception, this recycling payment system instills an artificial value into what would otherwise be a hazardous liability. This fact attracts not only responsible operators, but occasionally the misguided entrepreneur, and unfortunately, some who would attempt to defraud the system. My staff at CalRecycle handle all payment claims submitted by recyclers. Claims average almost $250,000 each, and some are as large as several million dollars. These claims must be reviewed for completeness and regulatory compliance, and we also test them for validity. That is, we check to see if they are truthful. Over the course of the program, CalRecycle has denied over $20 million in claim monies due to identified noncompliance. Typically, these problems are in the form of faulty source documentation. We only want to pay for covered electronic waste that originates from California sources. When we do identify documentation deficiencies, fabrications, or falsifications, whether that's the result of incompetence or criminal intent, we can and do make appropriate adjustments, denying payment as well as taking steps to revoke participation by those responsible for noncompliant activities. CalRecycle enjoys a memorandum of understanding with our friends at the Department of Toxic Substances Control on the matter of fraud investigation. This MOU was established in June 2007 to formalize responsibilities between the two organizations. Once CalRecycle has identified problematic documentation that may be indicative of fraudulent activity, it's brought to the attention of DTSC for further investigation and possible prosecution. I believe DTSC will address enforcement in a few minutes, but I want to acknowledge the cooperation that exists between the two organizations. Despite now being housed in entirely separate agencies, CalRecycle and DTSC have access to each other's data systems and are in regular communication on all aspects of the program. When it comes to fraud or attempted fraud, I know we would like to all see more perp walks. The paucity and pace of prosecution is frustrating, but I also believe that the public should feel confident that fee payer money is not being spent on non-compliant operations and it is being spent responsibly. On the matter of export, the Sacramento Bee last fall quoted unnamed industry sources alleging that hundreds of millions of pounds of raw, unprocessed electronic waste is being exported from California to fates uncertain. This assertion is as confusing as it is disconcerting. As I have noted, California's electronic waste recycling program pays only for video display devices that are dismantled into component parts within the state. However, we must recognize that essentially all derived commodities eventually leave California, as the demand for these resources is elsewhere. We recognize as well that the infrastructure fostered by the covered electronic waste recycling program also recovers substantial amounts of non-covered material, which is the rest of the electronic waste stream. That's the CPUs, the printers, the peripherals, and that material which cannot be disposed of with municipal solid waste. It must be noted that the export of electronic scrap is legal in the United States, and that the state of California cannot directly restrict this. However, I believe that the wholesale export of e-waste is not the prevailing practice among recyclers in California. In 2010, just five businesses participating in the covered electronic waste recycling program processed approximately 75% of all the material of all the covered electronic waste. That was there was 180 million pounds recycled that year. All of those entities have installed capacities to process mixed and miscellaneous e-waste. They do so out of a conviction, a client expectation, a pledge, or a certification, or simply the technological and economical aptitude to extract maximum value out of this complex resource. And many of the smaller recyclers operate in a similar fashion for similar reasons. This is not to say that export does not take place. And again, essentially all commodities derived from e-scrap eventually flow into a global market. But we must distinguish between what is generated here in California and how it is handled and what flows to and through California simply by virtue of the state's geographic location and its ports. Now, while on the subject of global markets, the next potential hiccup for California's e-waste efforts is the rapidly evaporating demand for CRT glass. Under current universal waste rules, CRT glass must be used as a feedstock for either new CRT manufacturing or lead smelting, and both of those markets have dim or distant futures. As I've noted, covered electronic waste recyclers must ship CRT glass before submitting payment claims. Meanwhile, CRT technology has been replaced by LCD, liquid crystal displays, or plasma, or other flat panel technologies, and the manufacturing of new CRTs will, for all intents and purposes, soon cease. There are only a few lead smelters in the Western Hemisphere, and with rumors of potential closures and an already low interest in CRT glass, smelting is not likely to pick up the slack in market demand for spent CRTs. I believe it is imperative that the recycling industry, regulators, and other interested stakeholders engage in an urgent and open discussion about the situation and explore what, if any, options are available under current rules and market conditions. Can CRT glass be safely used in other products or in other industrial processes? What are the consequences of no viable markets? Would domestic disposal be a tolerable alternative to a costly and carbon-intensive journey to the other side of the planet? And we don't have the answers to those today, but we'll need to come up with them very soon. Finally, after 6 years and £1 billion, California's program continues to be contrasted with the 24 other states that have since adopted e-waste legislation. Unlike California's state-administered fee and payment system, all of the other programs are some form of producer responsibility or product stewardship. Those are in varying stages of implementation and address different mixes of electronic devices. In those programs, manufacturer liabilities are assigned either through market share on new sales or return share of discarded devices. Some have goals and some do not. Some are operated by third-party contractors and some by a mix of industry associations. While California's success thus far is undeniable, it's also clear that a state-by-state approach to e-waste management is less than optimal. A national solution that creates green jobs and maximizes the domestic reutilization of valuable resources while protecting public safety and the environment will not happen overnight, but it should be pursued. In the meantime, thoughtful discussions about the effectiveness of California's experiment and the emerging experiences of other states should also be pursued. As we do that, we should not lose sight of the unique aspects of California's programs or its regulatory realities. In California, electronic waste is considered hazardous regardless of generator sector. This is not necessarily the case in other states where residential waste, by definition, is non-hazardous. California's covered electronic waste recycling program, both the fee assessment and the recycling opportunity, is open to all sectors, so long as there are California sources. Most other states exclude the business and commercial sectors. And California public funds under our program are used to pay only for the in-state processing of covered electronic waste, keeping jobs in California. And with that, I thank you for your time, and we'd be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Members, do we have questions of the witness? Well, let me ask. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
I guess the question that I have, we set up the program focusing on a limited amount of items, and we're quite concerned about the fraud and having tubes come from other states. Now that we've been in the program for 6 years, is that really a large concern? Because you've showed the chart that seems to be all those big picture tubes are no longer being made. And is that a necessary element of the program? Should we consider whether we would just accept any tubes, regardless of where they originated from, and not beyond the California purchasing?
Well, I personally believe that if California fee payers are funding the program, that it should pay for California's waste. Beyond that, I leave it to other policymakers to decide what California fee payers should pay for. The volumes of cathode ray tube devices, and that's over 99% of what we have seen come through the program so far, is our cathode ray tube devices, even though the fee is currently assessed on other technologies. There is a lot of that material still out there in the environment, within people's homes. We peaked at 62 million pounds, as I noted. We've fallen off, and that's because the easy pickings are gone. But televisions that are hooked up to cable or satellite, they were not affected by the digital transition. And we will continue to see CRT devices coming out of the public for quite a while still.
I guess the question is you indicated there was 2 million requests for payments over the life of the program that have been rejected as fraudulent.
20 million, yes.
20 million. This is a billion-pound program. Mm-hmm. So now that most of those, they may have tried to pass them off going forward in 2012 and 2011, is this going to be are we spending more money processing the program to make sure that people are in California, they purchase them in California, where it might actually be an insignificant amount of the total amount of tubes that we're going to get? I guess that's where I'm looking at the percentage going forward. I understand what happened in the past, but going forward, is it worth the money to have that as part of our program, whether we could use resources someplace else?
I believe that if there was not a fraud deterrent mechanism, that fraud would be rampant in the state, because material is being collected throughout the country because of the nature of California's location with ports and a gateway to the Far East. E-waste comes to and through California every day. If we are not vigilant to ensure that only California-sourced material is paid for by California ratepayers, then we will end up paying for the e-waste from the rest of the United States.
Now, from an environmental point of view, that might not be the worst thing in the world if we handled it, because the world would be a safer place, because it wouldn't be, these materials wouldn't be put in the refuge. You passed around, we have some props here sitting over there. I welcome Assemblymember Haldeman, who's joined us, and also Assemblymember Knight. What is in the glass and the funnel?
I brought examples of CRT glass separated, panel and funnel, panel being the front of a CRT and the funnel being the back part that typically is not seen by the consumer. In panel glass, to the best of our knowledge, it is relatively lead-free, but it contains barium as a mechanism to protect the viewer from X-rays generated by the functioning of a cathode ray tube. The funnel glass typically is leaded, anywhere from 15 to 20% lead content. The market for both of these types of glasses had robust markets as short as 3 to 4 or 5 years ago. Now those markets are going away.
And you also indicated there were a problem with the what to do with the glass, and that the smelters that are located around the states are not making any money. Where is the closest smelter to California? And I guess the next question would be, what does a used smelter cost nowadays? What is If we were dealing with just the California problem.
If you could cite a smelter in California?
Or maybe in another state that was the closest.
My understanding, the closest lead smelter might be in Trail, British Columbia. Or Doe Run, Missouri, domestically, heading north or heading east.
Okay. Chairman Chesbrough.
Yes, thank you. First of all, I want to acknowledge that I failed to acknowledge DTSC in my earlier comments about the folks who made the program get to where it is, and that was an oversight on my part. I'm just more focused on and familiar with CalRecycle, but obviously you played a key role, and thank you, Jeff, for gently reminding me. I do have a question. How hazardous are the new technologies, the LCD or plasma screens, and as we transition away from the old technology, will there be new issues associated with the markets for those materials?
I would almost want to defer to my colleagues at DTSC.
CRTs, the average CRT in 2001, our concern was there was about 8 pounds of lead in a CRT going into a solid waste landfill, not a hazardous waste landfill. Subsequently, we've tested a lot of other devices, and LCD televisions and plasma televisions are both hazardous waste, and they contain different constituents. They also contain lead, but they contain copper, they contain other heavy metals, cadmium, and so there's a variety of different chemicals in all of these devices. CRTs are relatively simple devices, and lead was the primary concern, but predominantly metals are our concern. There are concerns certainly about other constituents that may not be hazardous waste, like brominated flame retardants and things like that. But from a hazardous waste standpoint, it's mostly metals.
Thank you. Mr. Hunts, do we anticipate, or has there been any effort put into beginning to develop the markets for the newer products and marketing materials? Is there any parallel or similar issue with the new products that there is with the CRTs?
Well, as I noted, about 99% of what has come to and through the recycling program so far by weight has been cathode ray tube devices. We are seeing the next generation of display technology, the LCD screens, beginning to come through. Maybe some of the recyclers will talk about that later this morning. There remains a resale market for relatively new technology, LCD panels that are intact and can be repaired, are being diverted off to refurbishment and reuse. There are mechanisms by which that technology is also recycled. And once dismantled, you end up with a different mix of treatment residuals, we call them, or commodities. And in fact, that is another conversation that CalRecycle and DTSC does need to have with the industry. Right now, we have very burdensome documentation rules on the recycling of non-CRT devices because the residuals that result from the processing of non-CRT devices are just indistinguishable almost from the rest of mixed e-waste or a microwave oven. You know, with the CRT device, you end up with 50-60% by weight glass, and glass remains or regulated waste, and we can track that. And so we have not only a California source check, but also a volume or amount check. When we get into an LCD panel that's been stripped down to a bare panel and the mercury-containing lighting tubes on the back stripped off, you have plastics, you have some circuit boards, and you have an LCD panel, which by, I believe, DTSC's testing actually doesn't fail. The panel itself does not fail for hazardous waste, but there, as Carl noted, there are many other hazardous constituents in that product.
Thank you.
I think when you talked about a second hiccup, you were talking about the manufacturer liability, and it seems as though California has this fee-based program. It's working quite well. We identify certain products that we want to pay a fee for, and we're getting return, but there's all these other electronic products that I guess when Assemblymember Knight and I were at the Sims facility, it seems that those other products, those printers and microwaves and yada, yada, all those things are coming in, And I guess my question is how do we improve the California program? Is there some sort of a hybrid that would have an element of a manufacturing liability that would pay for this processing of all those other electronic components that are out there? Your comments.
Well, as we heard out at that tour, and as I learn every day from our participating recyclers, the volume of non-covered waste that they're expected to handle by their clients and by the supplying collectors is increasing as a proportion of what they manage, up to the point where they might be handling equal volumes of covered electronic waste, video display devices, and non-covered waste, the miscellaneous e-waste. That material has a mix of values to it, ranging from positive, for instance, a CPU or a computer tower. It's both its asset value and commodity value are relatively high, and so and things like cell phones, it makes sense, economic sense to recycle those. Other products, such as a personal printer, which is primarily plastic with very little metal value, might have a net cost to process it in state. So we know that the infrastructure that we have established, that it has been established by this program, is harvesting from Californians and both residents and businesses a substantial amount, if not most or all, of the e-waste generated in the state. The question really is, how is that other half being paid for? Does it have enough intrinsic value in it to pay for itself? And I think that's a question best left to the recyclers who will be testifying later.
Thank you very much. I'd like to welcome to the hearing Assemblymember Campos and Assemblymember Dickinson. Are there any other questions from members? Assemblymember Grove, please.
Thank you. Do you have any idea how much it costs small businesses to comply with this 2003 electronic waste program?
I would say that compliance with this program is a net benefit to small businesses because they are afforded free at the end of life recycling opportunities for what would have otherwise been a significant cost liability.
And do you know how much it costs the consumer to pay that fee up front?
I certainly do. It's the fee level is currently $6, $8, or $10 on a covered device, depending on the screen size.
Where does that money go?
That money is collected by retailers, remitted to the Board of Equalization, and deposited in the electronic waste recycling and recovery account.
Is there a surplus there now?
We did run a surplus. The legislature borrowed some of that surplus recently.
What did they do with it?
I believe it was used to patch holes in the general fund.
So we took monies from ratepayers and consumers. It was supposed to be for a specific thing, and it was used for other places?
That's my understanding.
And then I just have a comment. I have to respectfully disagree with the chair. I don't think it's a good idea for California taxpayers or ratepayers to pay for the rest of the world's waste and to come into California for us to pay for it. We're actually the highest taxed and fee-based state that we have, and so I respectfully disagree that I wouldn't want the rest of the world to have us pay for that. Thank you very much for that.
Assemblymember Knight.
I have a quick question, and it was on our tour. We were talking about the CRT glass. And in other places, the CRT glass is being used as some sort of other use. I think it was ground up, used in pavement and things of that nature. Again, I don't want to hurt the environment, and we're moving on a road here. But this CRT glass is coming in, and if we can use it, and it won't have any harm to us, isn't that something that we should explore?
We did learn on that tour from our hosts at Sims that in other countries, CRT glass is being put to other uses that would not be considered recycling in California. They would be considered uses that constitute disposal. I believe it was the Netherlands that was referenced that CRT glass as a whole or a portion thereof was being used in cement or roadbed for roads. I'm going to have to defer to my colleagues at DTSC about the nature of universal waste rules and hazardous waste rules and what is an allowable use. What we have spoke about and considered is that, you know, I think we could all agree that CRT glass encapsulated in cement is likely not going to present a threat to the environment. But 20 years from now, when that road is scheduled for repavement or refurbishment and somebody's removed the tag that says, careful, this road contains CRT glass, it might be leaded or might contain barium, and the contractor comes through and grinds that up and sends dust everywhere, we have a concern. So I do believe we need to look at other uses. We need to better understand what the actual nature of CRT glass is and what other industrial processes can be found to make use of this resource.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hunts. If you could stay while we have our next department, we have Carl Palmer, the Pollution Prevention Program, and Sue Laney with the Enforcement and Emergency Response Program. Thank you for coming this morning. Please proceed.
Thank you. Good morning, chairs and members. My name is Carl Palmer. I'm currently the manager of the Pollution Prevention Branch in the Department of Toxic Substances Control's Office of Pollution Prevention and Green Technology. I had the privilege to be part of the team of staff from DTSC and CalRecycle, formerly the Waste Board, who were responsible for implementing the Electronic Waste Recycling Act, and I appreciate the opportunity to be here today. I'll be providing a brief overview of DTSC's e-waste program and accomplishments, and my colleague Sue Laney will be providing some information about our e-waste compliance and enforcement activities. Much of what I'm going to cover is going to reflect Jeff's great testimony as well. As you know, along with cleaning up brownfields and promoting pollution prevention practices, DTSC is responsible for developing and enforcing regulations for the generation, management, transportation, treatment, and disposal of hazardous waste. This responsibility also includes the subset of hazardous waste that includes electronic waste. As indicated in Jeff's overview, our focus on e-waste began in 2001 when, in response to a question posed by Sheila Davis of Silicon Valley Toxics Coalition, who will be speaking later this morning, DTSC made the determination that discarded televisions containing cathode ray tubes were hazardous waste. This determination meant that televisions and CRT computer monitors could not be disposed of in non-hazardous solid waste landfills. In 2003, the passage of the Electronic Waste Recycling Act and the subsequent adoption of implementing regulations by both DTSC and the Waste Board provided the framework for a program designed to provide free and convenient recycling opportunities for consumers, which addresses your question, relieve local government's burden to pay for the management of these wastes, would promote the manufacture of electronic products with less hazardous materials in them. This was the restriction of hazardous substances provisions in the law. Support the development of collection and recycling infrastructure for e-waste and ensure that covered electronic waste are managed in a manner that protects our environment and the public. As Jeff highlighted, in these last 10 years, we've been successful in meeting those original objectives of the Act. In 2009, based on our reporting requirements, at least 3,500 separate sites collected e-waste in California, diverting over 288 million pounds of electronic waste from our landfills, and approximately 120 sites dismantled 277 million pounds of electronic devices and CRT devices. In 2003 and 2004, DTSC tested and classified numerous electronic waste as universal waste. Now, universal waste is a type of hazardous waste that is widely generated through our society, and due to the relatively low risk associated with its handling, has less stringent management and tracking requirements than industrial hazardous waste. The goal of classifying these wastes as universal waste was to encourage its collection and recycling by making universal waste management simpler and less costly than full hazardous waste management. Most universal wastes, such as batteries and aerosol cans, are not subject to DTSC reporting and notification requirements so long as they are ultimately recycled. However, electronic wastes are subject to notifications and reporting requirements. Still, since electronic wastes are not subject to the cradle-to-grave manifest requirements as are full hazardous waste, there are limitations on our ability to track the movement of these wastes between different handlers. There's an important distinction to make regarding what exactly is electronic waste. The covered electronic devices covered under the Act payment system are a subset of the larger universal waste that DTSC considers universal waste. We've tested video display devices to determine which ones were covered under the Act and adopted regulations listing these covered electronic devices. Then they include cathode ray tubes, televisions and monitors that contain CRTs, LCD televisions and monitors, laptop computers with LCD monitors, portable DVD players, and plasma televisions. All of these must have a video display device with a screen greater than 4 inches. DTSC receives aggregated data from each e-waste handler and dismantler to track where e-waste and certain residual components go and how much waste is treated. As universal waste, e-waste can travel to multiple handlers and or recyclers before it is no longer e-waste. Therefore, waste received can be counted multiple times when aggregating the annual report information. Handlers and recyclers of electronic waste are required to submit to DTSC an initial notification of their activity, an annual report, and file export notifications for consumer electronic devices and electronic waste. And those notifications are valid for 1 year. Regarding exports, we can require reporting on exports, but as a state, we have no jurisdiction to say what can or can't be exported. That's the domain of the federal government. US EPA requires a notification when CRTs are to be exported, and they correspond with the importing country to ensure that the waste can be imported. This is what Jeff was referring to when we had the issue with Mexico and the acknowledgement of consent process. I'll defer to Sue to enlighten us on some of the enforcement efforts along those lines. Based on our annual reports, the largest categories of e-waste leaving California are CRTs and CRT glass. In 2009, approximately 200 million pounds of CRTs and CRT glass left the state, while about 8 million pounds of other electronic devices left the state intact. Most of the electronic devices processed, about 150 million pounds, are dismantled here in California to maximize the commodity value of the components. CRT glass is a big challenge right now, as Jeff mentioned, because current regulations require that the glass go to new CRT manufacturing and to a lead smelter for the recycler to receive payment. However, within the last few months, the market demand for CRT glass essentially disappeared, and the few remaining CRT glass furnaces are inundated with glass from around the world. There's only one lead smelter in the U.S., and smelting the lead out of the glass is an inefficient process, so it's not desirable for the smelters. CRT glass is cleaned by a dry wash process in California to remove hazardous powder coatings and is slightly more valuable to overseas destinations because it can be more directly used in glass-to-glass manufacture. Two treatment facilities in California collectively clean millions of pounds of CRT glass per year. But as Jeff highlighted, viable alternatives to glass-to-glass recycling and smelting residual glass need to be carefully researched and evaluated because the glass is hazardous due to lead and barium, even when the hazardous coatings are removed. We recognize that the economy and the nature of e-waste devices have both changed significantly. We are open to working with the various stakeholders, including those testifying today and all of you, and to address program challenges in the future and develop solutions that will be protective of both public health and the environment. Now I'll introduce my colleague, Sue Laney, who is the Assistant Deputy Director for DTSC's Enforcement and Emergency Response Program.
Thank you, Carl. And Chairman and members, again, thank you. Appreciate the opportunity this morning to testify before you. My name is Sue Laney. I'm the Assistant Deputy Director for Enforcement and Emergency Response at the Department of Toxic Substances Control. And I will be providing a brief overview this morning of DTSC's enforcement and compliance program and the amount and nature of in-state inspections that are carried out to ensure compliance with the e-waste regulatory requirements enforced by DTSC. I will also give you some basic compliance statistics that reflect what DTSC inspectors and auditors are finding during e-waste handler field inspections and audit evaluations of the payment claims information. Looking at the overview, California's compliance efforts for e-waste management begins with DTSC's e-waste inspection of e-waste handlers and recyclers for compliance with the California Code of Regulations and the Public Resources Code. E-waste recyclers that are participating in CalRecycle's covered electronic waste payment program must be inspected by DTSC and found to be in compliance with applicable statutory and regulatory requirements prior to CalRecycle's payment of a claim. continued recycler participation in CalRecycle's payment program requires recyclers to be inspected annually, and recyclers must demonstrate continuing compliance in order to maintain eligibility for the payment program with CalRecycle. Inspectors evaluate operational practices statewide against a prescribed standardized inspection checklist, a copy of which you were provided a little earlier this morning. That checklist gives us a uniform yardstick and measurement tool to equitably apply the regulations and requirements across the board for all of those that are inspected by DTSC. The checklist is available on DTSC's website. We want it there to encourage handlers to do self-audits. We also want to promote voluntary compliance of the e-waste recycling and handling requirements. DTSC also provides online guidance for handlers to assist them with preparing for an e-waste inspection. No surprises. We want small businesses to know what's coming. We want them to have the information at their disposal so that they can accurately and adequately comply with the requirements and the regulations. DTSC's auditors and criminal investigators also evaluate suspect payment claim information for fraudulent documentation. This is the fraudulent documentation that Jeff referred to a few minutes ago, and I'll come back to that in just a minute. Looking at the compliance history, DTSC and CalRecycle have collaboratively provided outreach information and training to the regulated community. We want to give people the tools to be able to comply. However, DTSC inspectors continue to find non-compliant e-waste handlers in the universe of handlers that participate in the CalRecycle payment program. And since 2004, when DTSC began inspecting e-waste handlers and collectors, we have found the following. We have conducted 900-plus inspections of e-waste handlers. We've investigated some 20-odd administrative complaints who've come in through hotlines, telephone referrals, and through CalRecycle. We have found 500-plus violations of varying degrees of severity during the inspections. The inspection checklist will give you an idea of what kind of violations we do find. We are most concerned with the Class 1 violations, where we would find illegal disposal or illegal treatment that usually would come from the mismanagement of CRT glass at this point in time. We have initiated and settled 48 administrative actions, enforcement actions, and we have assessed and collected approximately $690,000 in administrative penalties over the prior 6 years, all associated with violations found during e-waste handler inspections. The enforcement investigations associated with fraudulent practices also continues. DTSC's e-waste fraud unit has received several cases from CalRecycling seeking investigation of potentially fraudulent payment claims from e-waste recyclers. And currently, DTSC has the following investigations and enforcement actions pending. Of the approximately 40 cases that have been referred to DTSC, 6 cases are currently under evaluation for criminal violations, looking to see if we have the evidence requisite to provide a court to prove the crime beyond a reasonable doubt. We have 9 cases that are pending administrative actions. We have 10 companies of those 40 that were referred to us that are no longer in business. And we have 14 complaints and referrals that we found insufficient evidence for criminal violations, and where administrative violations or actions can be taken against the lesser violations, they will be referred back to our e-waste inspection team to take administrative action. We also had 1 case referred to a local agency. So in a very brief overview, given the inspection and enforcement statistics accumulated to date, it does appear that enforcement and compliance will continue to be a key component in the future of e-waste regulation. And with that, I would like to invite any questions for either Carl or myself.
Thank you. I would like to acknowledge Assemblymember Fuhrer, who has joined us this morning. You've given us this the little checklist.
Yes.
Are the results available online or in some other means of the compliance or non-compliance. You've given us some information just today. I recognize that.
All administrative actions that the department takes for environmental enforcement are posted on the DTSC webpage under Managing Hazardous Waste and looking at enforcement in particular. When it comes to the actual checklist that you have in your hand, the checklist forms the basis of our inspection report that will be combined with perhaps photographs that would be taken of violations that were found during the inspection. In general, without redaction of the information, we would not be able to release it because of confidential business information, but we would certainly be more than happy to take a look at any Public Records Act requests and contact facilities to seek approval for provision of the inspection results.
Can you shine some light on the program as it's evolved? Because we've heard testimony that at the beginning of the program, it's 90% TV screens, and now it seems that it may be even more than 50%. And we have handlers, and then we have handlers. I helped the neighbor move the TV screen from the living room to the garage. So somebody may say I was acting as a handler because I don't know when do we so then I go to the high school and I drop it off, and the football player picks up the printer and they carry it onto a pallet, and the question is that a handler or is that just right tackle So as we get more waste that's not covered under our program is being touched by different people on the enforcement period, on the enforcement. So that's my premise on the enforcement. Are we going after the guy who's touching the printer, or are we going after the guy who is taking the unprocessed TV screen and putting it into a river?
If someone is generating a universal waste, which an electronic waste in this situation would be considered, households are exempt. And so you or I taking a TV to a collection event would not be a violation of the law.
Thank you.
So, however, if you or I were to take a television and dump it in a river, then we would have made a decision that that piece of electronic waste is a discarded waste. And by definition, by California's rules and regulations, that discarded waste is a hazardous waste. And so if you or I were to be caught dumping a CRT device into a river, then we could be held liable for a hazardous waste violation in that waterway.
So how about the entrepreneur who's not working, and he's got a pickup truck, and he just starts knocking on doors and saying, Mr. Wachowski, you got an old TV screen in your garage. I'll haul it away for you. And he goes to a processing facility and actually properly handles it. Does he come under the inspection checklist, or she?
Not in particular. If there's a local program, per se, that is having a local entity go around and collect, do authorized collection of devices from households, then there's an expectation there that the person who's doing the collecting would also complete the required inspection login the collection log information and have that document available for when it does make it to the actual collection center or collection facility. So this particular checklist is not necessarily going to apply to people that are going to be collecting CRT devices in that general manner. This checklist is going to apply to larger collectors who have business operations that are notified that are notifiers within the system, and recyclers that are the recipients of those larger volumes of collected CRTs.
And I guess before I ask other members, the EPA recently, or the federal EPA recently caught this group out of Minnesota that was trying to illegally export some electronic waste to Vietnam. Is the US EPA conducting similar investigations here in California, or is it just DTSC?
Right now, we just, well, as of this morning, I was just notified that Region 9 US EPA is taking a look at an investigation here in one of the ports in California. We have assigned a person within our e-waste team to be the liaison to that particular investigation. Resources are sometimes a little scarce on the federal side of the equation, however, when it comes to e-waste. However, they certainly are very, very concerned and interested in the export issue. So we are now seeing an uptick in the activity coming out of the Region 9 office working with DTSC on exports and inspections of different e-waste activities here in California.
Is the state able to assist the EPA if they have scarce resources, or are we using some of our enforcement muscle to assist them with a more comprehensive, investigation?
Yes.
Other members?
Chair Chesbrough.
Going back to Mr. Hunt's, sitting here listening, it occurred to me, having recently acquired example of the evolving technology. I bought an iPad, and I don't recall having paid the fee. And then so my first question is, does electronic devices of this sort are covered? And if not, why not? And then secondly, there's obviously evolution of the electronic readers as well, like the Nook and the Kindle. And so in terms of us keeping up with the evolution, the changing nature of the technology, how's the definition? Where is the line drawn, and how flexible is it?
Yeah, absolutely. The evolution of technology has brought us products today that were never envisioned when SB 20, the Electronic Waste Recycling Act, first passed. That the act laid out broad definitions for what a covered electronic device is. It's a video display device with a screen size greater than 4 inches that has been tested by DTSC and added in regulation to Appendix X of Chapter 10 of Title 22, I believe. So with that, I would defer to my friends at DTSC about whether or not any given video display device is a covered
Right. As Jeff highlighted, the statute requires that we actually test a specific device to see if it meets the statute's criteria and that it fails our hazardous waste criteria. And we have not tested some of those types of devices. We're looking at the spectrum of the various products out there that become waste that might be subject to the statute, and we still are
so
deciding.
How is that process? Do you have the resources to be testing new products as they come onto the market? We've now had, I think, Kindles for several years, iPad for probably a year, and obviously new ones are going to be rolling into the market as we speak. And so
it's a difficult thing to keep up with because we have to do it via regulation, and the devices change faster than we can keep up with in some sense. So if you look at what we've already listed, we try to categorize things as much as possible if the technology is similar, so CRT devices or LCD monitors. But and you might ask Doug Smith from Sony how many different product design cycles they go through in the time that we do a regulation.
But it's come to mind. Yeah. On the one hand, it could be a form of green chemistry in the sense that
yes,
if you could get out of the program by designing a less toxic product, then there's some incentive there. On the other hand, if you don't think you're going to get regulated because the state's so slow, you might not be as apt to care. And then there's the market distortion factor of giving an advantage to a newer product if, in fact, it has as much or more toxic content as an old product, and yet we're so slow to pull them in, and so they're not subject to the fee just simply because we haven't gotten to them.
Well, I think let me say, I mean, we do have the bandwidth to do it, and we are looking at which devices are next in the queue.
Okay.
But
it seems like it's a continual process.
It is a continual process.
I mean, catching up is one thing, but then I think we're all pretty sure from the last 10 or 15 years that things are going to continue to change really rapidly.
But I think that, for example, to use your device, we wouldn't specify the brand of that device. We would say devices that has these characteristics,
right,
and we would try to get a representative sample of those types of devices so that we could capture similar things as best as possible.
And Chair Chesbro, just to further complicate the matter, can you make a telephone call on that iPad?
Not at the moment.
Okay.
Well, it depends.
You probably could. If you had Wi-Fi, you could Skype and make a phone call. And if you, depending on what data plan you subscribe to, a 3G or 4G plan, you could probably use that iPad as a telephone, as a cell phone. And in California, we have the Cell Phone Recycling Act passed in 2004 that requires all retailers of cell phones to take back those devices. And
so has anybody attempted to exercise that with regards to computing devices that that access technology like Skype?
I don't know about that.
I think the other issue is, as Jeff pointed out, right now we are the fee system is paying for legacy waste for technologies that are essentially dinosaurs. And
well,
so
there's more to it than taking them back in. There's the equity of how it gets charged and market impacts of that. Mm-hmm. So I mean, that obviously is very important, but who's currently contributing is who's paying for the old devices to be recycled, right?
Right.
Right. And while our goal is to take the hazardous materials out of the waste stream are laudable, we also have goals of just generally recycling for the plastics and the aluminum and the other materials that are there. Assemblymember Grove.
I just have a few questions. One for you, and then I want to go back to that fee thing. Out of those 500 plus violations, how many were class ones?
I can tell you precisely. It's a lesser number.
You said those are the ones you were most concerned with. So I just
yes.
How many there were?
Of those violations, we had 49 that were class ones, 240 that were class twos, and 314 that were minor violations. And as defined by California law, a minor violation is a violation which we do not take enforcement action against unless it's a repeat violation and it's a recalcitrant violator. So if somebody has a minor violation, for instance, they have not completed properly a label that's on a carboy of monitors or a pallet of monitors, and we would note that in our inspection report that they failed to properly label. That would be a minor violation if it was just a couple of elements in that label that were missing. However, if we came back 2 years later, which we have, we've got examples of that, and found that that exact same violation occurred again, then that violation no longer is a minor violation and it gets bumped up to class two.
Okay, for a label, correct?
Well, yes, for a label. But it usually means that there's going to be more than just one label. I mean, usually when we're talking, usually, you know, multiple labels on multiple pallets.
Okay, then I want to go back to that fee thing, that $6, $8, or $10 fee thing that you mentioned that's paid. Who sets that fee? Is that legislative or is that something your department
does? The fee was originally set in statute with SB 20 at the $6, $8, or $10 level. As I noted in 2008, what was then the Integrated Waste Management Board, through public hearings, acted to increase the fee in order to maintain solvency in the program. As the chart shows that I handed out, volumes in the program then moderated and actually fell off, and we've run into a few things that have slowed recycling along the way. So we did build up a I would call it an excess reserve of funds that we are now working to bring back to a more prudent level through reducing the fee back to the original level.
I guess that was my question, is if you have, I just looked at some paperwork, said you had $153 million surplus, you loan the general fund $80 million, and you got $56 million left in your surplus. To me, that shows me that the fees are a little bit high to begin with if you have that type of surplus. And I represent people that are sitting around the kitchen table trying to make ends meet.
Right. So, well, when I can... The way I'd like to address that is that the point that the Integrated Waste Management Board increased the fee, we were facing imminent insolvency. We had built up an initial reserve when revenue outpaced the size of the program, and let's say late 2007, we crossed a threshold where what we were paying out was actually more than what was coming in, and so we started tapping into those reserves, and then by the end of 2008, what we had projected is that we were going to be insolvent. In fact, I believe we sought loan permission to from the Department of Finance to get a short-term loan in case of that eventuality. The program did continue to grow after 2008, but nobody really saw the economy, the global economy driving off a cliff and slowing down consumption. No TV. Everybody seemed to need a big screen TV, and because our fees were higher on the larger devices, that was one of the reasons why we continued to see revenue in excess of what we needed to pay out. When we were confident that the trend line for our expenditure needs was heading down, we acted to reduce the fee levels, again, back to the original rate. And I should note that the $6, $8, or $10 that is assessed on a consumer is only a fraction of what an actual device costs to recycle. So, and this works, like many pyramid schemes, because these are durable goods, that what is sold today stays in use. It's sold at a garage sale, it's passed, it's moved to a spare bedroom. It's not like a beverage container that's bought last week and recycled next week. So the fee payer is not actually even paying the full price of what it costs to recycle.
Isn't the recycling company paying a fee for that as well?
No.
I mean, if a recycling company is required to recycle something and sell it to the facility that's in what Columbia, or you said, or
the program is designed, and the payment rates for collection and recycling are by statute intended to cover the average net cost of recovery and recycling as an industry as a whole. So when we talk about averages, that by definition means that somebody's costs are higher than that and somebody's costs are lower than that. But as a whole, and through our analysis, what we set the payment rate at is sufficient to cover the cost. So when you talk to the recyclers that will testify later this morning, they will confirm that what the state pays them covers their costs of recovering and recycling covered electronic waste.
What's an adequate reserve? What do you think an adequate reserve is?
By statutory requirement, I believe it's set at 5%. But when a program is growing at double-digit percents or fluctuating at double-digit percents over the course of a year, maintaining that 5% in an attempt to achieve statutory requirements is a difficult thing.
Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry. We have we're a mere 35 minutes behind. Assemblymember Haldeman had a question, and then Assemblymember Fuhrer and Monning.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. I do feel the need to say that the largest TV and monitor recycler in the state is in Fresno, which has an unemployment rate of 18.7% currently. So we very much appreciate the jobs and tax base that company provides. But I do need to say that in the first year of this program, close to $2 million in fraudulent and faulty claims were identified, whereas in 2009, that number hit $10 million. So my question to you is, how do you get the number of fraudulent and faulty claims closer to zero without endangering the jobs provided, for example, in the Central Valley?
I'll take a shot at that. I'm sorry, I didn't catch the first number you quoted there. It's my program, the program that I manage, responsibility to review payment claims. Those are submitted by recyclers. They are comprised of collection documentation, transfer documentation, processing documentation, the documentation that shows that the various residuals are sent to appropriate end markets. As I noted, we test those claims not only for regulatory compliance but for validity. And when we test those claims, sometimes we do find that documentation has, we characterize it as inconsistencies in the documentation. We believe, in fact, that the denial of payment is the most effective feedback to this industry. They know what the rules are. They're in this, at the recycler level, they understand what is required. We work in partnership with the recyclers. We identify where the problems are in the claims. We encourage the recyclers to enter into smart business arrangements with their collectors to protect themselves. These are, after all, business transactions. And I'm sure you'll hear later this morning that all recyclers in the program have been stung by working with less than scrupulous operators who may have gathered covered electronic waste from who knows where and brought it to them. In other words, the system is self-correcting through the denial of payment, and we work closely to provide information and assistance.
Mr. Fuhrer.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So I'm all for reducing fees wherever they're improperly calibrated so that they can reflect the actual cost of a program. However, I was late this morning because of my plane flight, and as a consequence, if I've missed this discussion, please stop me and I'll take my answer offline, as they say. The Bee did an article in November, and it mirrored a couple of news reports that I saw. I think it was a 60 Minutes story and a Frontlines or others, about the exportation of electronic waste from California elsewhere. Numbers are put at a couple hundred million pounds a year, I think, something in that range. So what I want to know from this panel and perhaps from others as well is the pretty fundamental answer to the fundamental question. What are we doing as a state to enforce existing laws to clamp down on the illegal exportation of this waste? Because I think that unless you tell me that it's an improper use of the fee, which I'd be interested in hearing, that the fee should be used for part of a comprehensive program that includes enforcing this law. We currently have a very inadequate enforcement system, burgeoning markets overseas, and what this program has succeeded in doing is in part create, I'd like to create about 30 times the number of jobs in Fresno that Ms. Haldeman referred to. I think that'd be great. Instead, we're exporting those jobs to China and elsewhere because people aren't complying with the rules and causing pollution that's creating unbelievable health problems in other countries. So can we attribute the fee to enforcing our laws? If so, how can we do so? If not, what alternative enforcement means do you have in place to deter what is going on?
Yeah, we talked about that already.
Okay, you did.
No, I'm kidding.
No, you know, don't tell me that toxic guys can't be funny.
We've all seen the video, the 60-minute video, the band videos, yeah. the horror stories, women and children breaking apart things, burning, yeah. Open burning. The covered electronic waste program, the televisions and monitors, the video display devices that are paid for by public funds collected from fee payers are dismantled here in California. Their component parts, the treatment residuals, the commodities do enter a global marketplace. The large recycler in Fresno also has installed capacity to process, to shred, to magically separate the metals, the circuit boards, the plastics into higher value commodities. I will defer to their own testimony, but while the Bee article did attempt to tag the recycling system and operators in California with certain activities, and I won't exhaustively go through it again, I believe that the vast majority of even non-covered electronic waste in California is processed in California into commodities prior to exportation. The Bee quoted unnamed industry sources, DTSC's own export.
So the 60 Minutes story and the Frontline story and so forth misstate the problem?
No. The export occurs. Absolutely, export occurs. The state of California does not have the constitutional authority to directly restrict the export of electronic scrap. We do so through incentive in the covered electronic waste program by only paying for what is dismantled here in California. It's a large country, lots of e-waste available for export. California does have four major ports that head to the Far East, and do some of those shipping containers contain e-waste? Absolutely.
Let me chime in, yeah. Jeff. I think that it's important to note that the covered electronic waste has led to the development of an infrastructure of collection and processing, which has also benefited the non-covered electronic waste, which otherwise might be shipped off out of California overseas, lock, stock, and barrel in its, you know, bulk form. Now, because the market is there and the infrastructure is there and the jobs are there to actually legitimately process those materials under the oversight of California DTSC's Universal Waste Management Program, in addition to the covered electronic waste, all those other electronic waste are getting processed to the extent we can here. And yes, the market is overseas, so most of that stuff does end up leaving the state.
I want to,
but it's much better than it was.
I'm sorry.
Sorry.
I also want to say that it's my memory that the 60 Minutes report and the Frontline report were about the country, and that some of the specific examples they gave were other places in the country, not specifically focused on California. And it's not to contradict that there's a problem. I'm not.
Yeah, no, I
just wanted
I remember
to point out that it was focused on sort of the larger national problem than on specifically California.
Yeah, I remember very clearly though the exportation from Bay Area ports, and again, I am very cognizant of the time constraint here, but my real question wasn't whether there's a problem. We can disagree about that. I think that most objective observers would say two things. First, that this is a very important program for California to have, but I'm not contesting that. The question is how we make it as effective as possible. That's what oversight is about. I am concerned that we aren't doing enough to interdict the illegal exportation of e-waste from California ports. My question really was whether the fee could properly be attributed to such exercises, perhaps in conjunction with federal and other authorities, whether the fee could not properly be devoted to that purpose. And do we know the answer to that question?
Right now, the fee is assessed on covered electronic devices. The payments are made, the payments that cover the cost of processing in California are on covered electronic waste. Absent a statutory change, I don't believe that we could directly fund and provide the incentive, however much it is needed, for the balance of currently non-covered waste to be paid for, if necessary, as the law is currently constructed.
Mr. Chair, I just want to say one thing, and that is that it isn't clear to me that the problem of exportation of e-waste is limited to that which is not covered under the California program. And I'll leave it at that.
Mr. Monning, one last question of this panel. And
my question was also going to go to export issues, and I think in the interest of time, I'll wait till the next panel. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, panel. We'd like to welcome Assemblymember Brownling, who's here, and we'll move on to part two on the public health issues and environmental issues with regarding the current e-waste management. We have from the Silicon Valley Toxics Coalition, Sheila Davis, and Californians Against Waste, Mr. Mark Murray. Thank you for your patience this morning. Ms. Davis, please proceed. Thank you for testimony.
Thank you. Mr. Chair and committee members, I am Sheila Davis, and I'm the executive director of the Silicon Valley Toxics Coalition. And I thank you very much for inviting me to speak here today. The problem of electronic waste in California is critical. The 2003 California Electronic Recycling Act was the first electronic recycling law in the nation. In many respects, the California Electronic Recycling Act is a beta version of recycling laws. Since 2003, more than 16 states have passed e-waste recycling laws, and many states have significantly improved on California law by requiring manufacturers to contribute and participate in the state recycling program and effectively restricting the export of electronic waste. The California Electronic Waste Recycling Act has proven limited in scope in terms of the products that are received, and it has not gone far enough in protecting human health and the environment. I actually became involved in this issue as a legislative aide many years ago in the mid-90s. And I say that because this issue has been around for a long time. That at that time, the late Senator Marks wanted to make sure that there was an infrastructure for this new waste stream. Unfortunately, the bill was vetoed. I continued to work on this issue because I was interested in creating jobs and recycling. I worked with the Community Economic Development Group that did that and ran into some barriers in terms of determining whether or not the waste could actually put in the landfill. I did, in fact, write the letter to the Department of Toxics and Substance Control that triggered the landfill ban in the state of California. Since, I've worked with Silicon Valley Toxics Coalition as the executive director, and one of the most important lessons I've learned is that you cannot recycle materials, and I learned this as a community development expert, in communities and do it effectively without the manufacturer's participation in designing the products to be recycled and in taking consideration for the life cycle impacts of those products. After almost 15 years in this field, I still strongly believe in the potential that e-waste policies can create recycling jobs, protect human health, and extend the responsibility to manufacturers and do this in an economically feasible way. In California, we should be proud that we are leaders in passing e-waste recycling laws, and we were the first. But we also must recognize that the current version of a law is not up to the task. It does not do all the things that we need in the state. It does not do it in an economic fashion. Effectively, it does not create as many jobs as we could potentially create, and it does not involve the manufacturers as we should involve them. I know these laws are not working also because I have gone to some of these countries where waste is being dumped. I've gone to India, and I have seen documentation that some of the waste actually leaves the shores from California and does go to India, and that in these communities in Delhi, I've seen young children smashing CRTs, smashing printers that are not covered electronics. I don't know if they're for sure from California, but children being exposed to carbon black from printers that are not regulated. Our electronics are basically harming people around the world in our attempt to keep them out of the landfill, which is important to protect our environment, but it's also important to address issues of global health. At SVTC, we recommend the following changes for the California recycling laws that we feel will help improve the laws. Firstly, SVTC recommends that the state of California require all authorized e-waste recyclers to become certified e-stewards. The e-steward certification is developed by the Basel Action Network and is an audited system that requires e-waste recyclers to recycle responsibly in the U.S. Currently, it is deceptive for Californians to go to the state website and find a list of authorized e-waste recyclers and assume that because the state has authorized these recyclers, that the recyclers are actually handling the products responsibly. Santa Clara County recently passed an ordinance requiring the use of e-stewards for its products, and we believe that the state can tighten the laws and require some type of audited system for all e-waste recyclers handling state products that are covered by the state. Secondly, SVTC strongly recommends that manufacturers financially contribute to recycling and developing infrastructure in the state. Unfortunately, the current law only asks customers to pay a recycling fee. It does not ask the manufacturers to contribute to this cost. However, the manufacturers are the ones that are responsible for designing the product so that they can be recycled properly, and they are also responsible for putting the toxics in the products that caused the problems in the first place. Other states have been able to effectively, like Washington and Minnesota, include manufacturers, and given California's financial crisis, I think we should do the same. Thirdly, SVTC recommends that products that are covered by the law should be expanded to all consumer electronics with a plug. Currently, Only certain visual displays and laptops, as we've discussed here earlier, are covered by the law and the processing fee. We are well aware that products that are not covered by the law and that are not do not receive state payments are collected along with covered electronics. However, because recyclers don't get paid, these products are shipped overseas where they are paid for. And I do want to note that I did go to purchase a phone for my daughter at Verizon Wireless this past weekend, and I asked them to take back the phone, and they acted clueless. So the phones are not, the 2004 Cell Phone Act, the retailers are not responsive, and they do not take responsibility. Finally, and most importantly, the law should not be static. The electronic industry rapidly changes, and the innovation continues. In California, we need laws that are flexible and that continue to change with the innovation. In Silicon Valley, there is already a new wave of technology. It's called clean technology. SVTC is looking very closely at it because despite the name of being clean, we know that it has many of the same types of environmental impacts as electronics. And I'm talking about solar panels, and I'm talking about electronic car batteries, as well as some of the newer types of electronic products that are including nanomaterials. California electronic recycling laws should provide a means to continue to review, test new policies, and evaluate policies so that the state is not stuck with a beta version of e-waste recycling laws when the rest of the world and the electronic industry is moving on to e-waste recycling version 2.0. Thank you. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Mr. Murray, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Mr. Chairman, members, Mark Murray with the Environmental Group Californians Against Waste. We were one of the legislative sponsors of the original legislation by Senator Schur, SB 20. And I think it's important, especially in an era of term limits, to understand what were the objectives when this program was enacted and how have we done in terms of achieving those objectives. The objective was, in part, thanks to Sheila's communication to DTSC, was finally a recognition that electronics were hazardous waste. It was almost like a letter from 1984 from the novel in that electronics are hazardous waste. They've always been hazardous waste. They've always been banned from landfill. We just didn't tell anyone about it. So California moved forward with a focus on the CRT devices, the TVs, the computer monitors, and that was the focus of the original legislation because that's what DTSC told us was hazardous. That legislation moved forward. At the time, we're fortunate that we had a waste characterization study from before the program began, and now we've got one 5 years afterwards that we can take a look at. How did we do in terms of diverting these covered devices from landfill? And you know, back in 2003, looking at what was in the landfill, there were 226,000 tons of covered electronics, devices covered by the Act that were going to landfill in California. We've reduced that to 52,000 tons, so it's an overall 77% reduction in the amount of covered devices that are going to landfill. I think really significantly in looking at those numbers, we break up the waste stream commercial, residential. We've achieved an 89% reduction in the covered electronic devices going to landfill from the residential stream. So residents in California, without an incentive, just having free cost of collection, free cost of proper management, have achieved nearly a 90% reduction in these covered devices. I've been working on.
Do we have those numbers for the uncovered devices or anything approaching it?
Yeah, we do.
Because I assume a sort of collateral.
There is. There
effect
is.
Is the.
There is, and I guess I just want to focus.
I assume that's probably 939 measurements that would measure that.
Yes, the waste characterization studies, which I actually have this, but it's such a complicated looking chart, I wasn't going to pass out, but I can.
Well, I meant the question. You can ask more specifically than I did. I meant the question generally, whether or not we have anything equivalent happening with the.
Yes. Here's just a point I want to make, is that I've been working on recycling policies for an awful long time, Assemblymember Chesbro even longer than I, and I'm hard-pressed to think of an example of where we've reduced the problem by 90% in 5 years. That's a significant reduction in terms of waste. Interestingly, the commercial sector has not done as well in terms of their reduction. Overall reduction was 77%. Commercial stream, only a 63% reduction. Now, at that same time, we did create this infrastructure, and that private sector infrastructure has facilitated the recycling of a lot of the uncovered devices. And we've got about a 50%, nearly a 50% recovery of those uncovered devices. Now, we're going to hear from the private sector recyclers. Some of them will say they were motivated to create this opportunity to recycle these other devices. Others will say that they were leveraged, they were compelled by the local government collectors who said, if you want the good stuff, if you want the stuff you're going to get paid on, you got to take this other stuff. So another objective of the legislation was to deal with this export issue. And the direct answer to Mr. Feuer's question of what are we doing in terms of this violation of law, the correct answer is it's not a violation of law. It is not a violation of federal law. It is not a violation of state law to export these devices. That's unfortunate. Our hands have been tied by the federal government's inaction on dealing with the export issue and by the fact that the Commerce Clause prevents us as the state of California for dealing with this issue directly. So what we attempted to do with SB 20 was to create a financial incentive to work around the Commerce Clause to create a financial incentive to motivate these electronic recyclers to properly manage these devices, to not export them without dismantling them, without turning them into commodities first. And that solution, as imperfect as it was, as limiting as it was because we can't prohibit the export, that has been relatively effective. But it's effective only if DTSC enforces it. And the enforcement mechanism is all of these recyclers prior to export provide a demonstration to DTSC of how they're handling these devices. And, you know, I think that with all due respect to the state agencies, I think they could be doing a better job under existing law of enforcing that export requirement. A lot of their violations that I've identified are mishandling of the devices here in California. That's important to do, but I don't feel that it's been an enforcement priority for DTSC to take a look at those demonstrations, take a look at that paperwork, and make sure that every recycler is playing by the same rules. Now, fortunately, we've got some of the larger recyclers in the state here. I think a lot of these guys are playing by the rules. I'm concerned that there are a lot of other recyclers that are not playing by the rules, and I think it's in terms of what would be helpful to our economy, what would be helpful in terms of what we think is the right thing to do with these devices would be for Department of Toxics to make it an enforcement priority to make sure that these devices are compliant with the intent of the California law. Now, that law only focuses on the covered devices. The incentive, as it's structured right now, says you get paid if you're properly handling the covered electronic devices. Now, the ideal situation is that we expand this law to include, as Sheila has described, anything with a plug or a battery. That's what we should do. First step is we should expand this law to include all toxic electronics. But at the very minimum, if we're paying a recycler to recycle under this law, we're subsidizing the cost of recycling this, we should expect them to play by the rules, by our rules in terms of export, on every device they're handling, not just the covered devices, but any electronics that they're handling. We've introduced with Assemblymember Lowenthal legislation that would address that piece of it. That's, in my view, that's the compromise legislation. We should be looking at expanding this entire law. I'm not sure that politically, economically, the timing is right for expanding this law. But at minimum, if we're going to be paying money to a recycler under this law, they should be handling every single one of the devices they're touching, whether it's covered or uncovered, properly and consistent with our objectives, which is to not have these devices dismantled in other states, in other countries. So, you know, just in wrapping up here, one other point. I think the US EPA enforcement is an absolute joke. There is no enforcement. What EPA is getting down on these recyclers from Minnesota and elsewhere on is because their paperwork was inconsistent. The problem that where we've busted these folks is because they mislabeled the containers. But EPA is not prohibiting anyone from exporting CRTs or other devices to developing countries. That's not the mission. The mission, instead, is making sure you got your paperwork correct. The federal government, unfortunately for us at the present political moment, is the only one that can take action to ban the export of toxic electronics to the developing world to third world countries, and they haven't done that for the last decade. I don't think that this federal government is going to move forward on that issue right now.
Briefly, why is that?
I think there's an international treaty, the Basel Action Treaty, which prohibits the export of hazardous materials to developing countries. The United States is not a signatory to that trade agreement. Because the Commerce Clause prohibits the state, according to Legislative Council, the Commerce Clause prohibits the state of California from passing a law to restrict export. And in fact, they've given us a hard time with regard to this incentive-based proposal, suggesting that it does raise Commerce Clause questions because clearly the intent is to influence export. We're doing it with an incentive. I believe that it's an issue that's worthwhile to go to bat on in terms of, I dare someone to challenge us in terms of us using our money to incentivize recycling the way we want it to be done and challenge it under the Commerce Clause. So,
thank you very much. Trying to get back on schedule, I think we'll just move to the market conditions in international markets and hear from some of the people out in the field that may be illuminating. So I'll ask right now Mr. Biddle and Mr. Smith to come forward. Mike Biddle is the president of Post-Consumer Plastics Recycler, MBA Polymers, and Douglas Smith is the Director of Corporate Environment, Safety, and Health for Sony Electronics, Inc. Gentlemen, thank you for being here this morning. Mr. Biddle, proceed.
Thank you for your time, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here today. I would like to commend the committees for recognizing the importance of this subject and the relevance to some other challenges that our state is facing today. My name is Mike Biddle. I'm president of MBA Polymers, a company I founded 18 years ago to develop and implement a more sustainable way to manufacture plastics. We're now the world leader in mining and recycling plastics from end-of-life computers, electronics, appliances, and automobiles. We're headquartered in the Bay Area in Richmond, California, where we have an operations center, a research center, and a small production line. But we have built and now operate the most advanced plastics recycling facilities in the world, in Asia, and in Europe. And because they're in Asia and Europe is part of the reason I'm here speaking to you today. We're located there because those two regions of the world have implemented large-scale recycling of end-of-life durable products. Our company's been recognized for its breakthrough technology through awards such as the World Economic Forum Tech Pioneer Award, Tech Museum Environmental Award, Thomas Alva Edison Award for Innovation. We were named one of the top 100 clean tech companies in the world the last 2 years in a row. And just a few months ago, The Economist magazine named us the winner of its 2010 Award for Innovation in Energy and the Environment. And I tell you these things just to give you some perspective on our role in this rapidly developing business and technology area, but also to point out to you the importance that many prestigious institutions place on recycling, not only as a way to protect the planet, but as a way of growing sustainable businesses and jobs, something important to most of the world these days. On one side of our business, we mine the plastics from materials that are left over from some of the recyclers you're going to be hearing from today, namely electronics and even automobile recyclers, who recover the metals. We take what's left over, which is their shredder residue, which is a complex mixture of materials that often would be landfilled or incinerated. And from this, we recover not only a number of different types of plastic products, but even some rubber and metals that the metal recyclers miss. And by working very closely with literally hundreds of computer and electronics recyclers from all over the world, we know firsthand the breadth of approaches to collect, transport, and recycle end-of-life computer and electronics. And in fact, I've personally seen the most primitive to the most sophisticated recycling approaches and technologies being practiced all over the world and everything in between since we work with so many of the international recyclers. On the other side of our business, we sell our recycled plastics right back to some of the largest IT manufacturers in the world, some here in California, electronics and automobile manufacturers. And this gives us an understanding of the challenges and opportunities these manufacturers face in using recycled materials in their new products. We close the loop, and we help manufacturers create cradle-to-cradle solutions for their businesses. So I hope this little introduction explains to you why I was asked to be a witness at this hearing today. My testimony can be summarized very simply. We believe that California is missing both a timely leadership and an enormous economic opportunity by following our current practice of mostly wasting many of our valuable resources. Even Tom Friedman, just a few months ago, pointed out in a New York Times editorial that he wrote about our company that we are missing not only the opportunity to lead the world in protecting people in the increasingly fragile ecosystems, but we're also missing out on the clean tech job creations, resource security, and energy savings associated to mining valuable materials from end-of-life durable goods in almost every other developed, like almost every other developed world country in the world is already doing today. We're sort of the last to come to recognize this as an economic opportunity. For the most part, we bury or at best ship our waste to others who add the majority of the value by extracting, refining, and upgrading materials for use in new products. The U.S. and in particular the U.S. and particularly California has the largest deposit of end-of-life electronics in the world. You might say that we have the richest above-ground mines in the world, and that's certainly how we look at it. We look at ourselves as a mining company. And these mines, by the way, are much richer in metals, even rare earth materials, critical materials, and plastics than either ore or mineral mines or oil wells. But like below-ground mining, these streams also contain numerous materials of concern that need to be properly handled with the appropriate knowledge and technologies. And to put the size in perspective, in some of the written testimony that I provided to the committees, I referenced one study that estimates that the U.S. generates over 20 million metric tons of e-waste per year. That's over 40 billion pounds. That's a much bigger number than we've heard talked about so far this morning. And if you think of California representing 10 to 15% of the U.S. economy, we have 10 to 15% of that, so 2 to 3 million tons, or up to 5 to 6 or 7 billion pounds a year, much bigger number than we've heard talked about. And this is because the definition that most countries apply to e-waste is anything with a cord or battery, much larger and broader definition than we currently look at e-waste today. And so this is the definition that I'm going to proceed with because it captures both the issues and the opportunities that I'd like to briefly discuss in the rest of my testimony. So much of the obsolete electronics in the U.S. and California are stored in closets and garages. The majority of the rest is disposed of in landfill or incinerators. We have heard that some of it is processed in state, and I think a growing amount of it is processed in state because of the current policies. But we're missing the vast majority of it. The EPA estimates that less than 20% of even the highest value portions of this stream, which is the computers and IT equipment, is recycled in the U.S., and certainly far less than 20% of the less valuable portions. Unfortunately, even the small amount that is collected for recycling is often shipped overseas to developing countries. We've already heard about that. We've heard about the articles that have been written, the videos, so I'm not going to go on about that because I think everyone's aware of the way this material can be mishandled. And most of this e-waste that has been that is being delivered and being mishandled improperly, unfortunately, comes from the United States, and much of it does indeed come from California. I've seen it with my own eyes. I've been to India, I've been to China, and I've seen many of these practices myself over the last 18 years. From an environmental stewardship standpoint, our country, and especially California, should take a leadership position in the responsible management of our large collection of e-waste. We are one of the last developed countries in the world to have a national policy for these wastes, and even though we have the largest amount of this waste in the world. And with California's history as a technology leader, we believe it should naturally be the clean tech leader as well. And even if you don't buy into the environmental stewardship responsibility, just as importantly, we're missing a significant opportunity to reap some enormous economic benefits from recovering some of the materials from these end-of-life products domestically. Examples include shovel-ready jobs. The scrap recycling industry in the U.S. already employs over 85,000 people and generates over $85 billion in revenues, and we still are not capturing a huge portion of our waste streams. Enormous energy savings can be realized through the reuse of making materials rather than making them from new. Reusing metals and plastics can require as little as 10% of the energy savings compared to making them from virgin materials. There are very few other opportunities in the world I'm aware of where you can slash energy use by 90%. There are also concurrent significant greenhouse gas savings from using recycled materials, largely attributable to the energy savings. So let me put this a little bit in more perspective by looking at plastics. That's something we know about, not just because we recycle plastics, but because it's the last major material category to be recycled in large volumes. The EPA estimates that less than 7% of the plastics are recovered in the U.S., so there's a large opportunity here. If we were to only recover half of the plastics coming back from end-of-life electronics and automobiles, just those two categories of durable goods, we could save over 9 million barrels of oil a year. We could save something like 15 billion kilowatt hours of energy per year, and we could save over 5 billion pounds of CO2 from being emitted into the atmosphere every year. And I've provided other economic benefits in my written testimony, so I won't take up the committee's time with that. So I'll wrap up with three specific, relatively simple, and straightforward policies that we believe California could adopt to reap these important benefits and also claim a leadership position in this area. Firstly, we need to increase the types of products covered by responsible end-of-life management to include all products with a cord or battery, just like Europe and many other developed regions are doing today. We also recommend extending this to automobiles, but this hearing is about electronics, so I'll stick to that. So why should California extend the coverage so broadly? Firstly, the challenges and opportunities extend well beyond IT equipment, well beyond the covered goods that we've talked about today. It also significantly increases the amount of materials for recycling. And why is that important? It's important because that allows recyclers to create larger businesses, some of which you're going to hear from later today. They can take advantage of state-of-the-art technologies, and they can take advantages of economies of scale, so they can make their operations more efficient with assured larger volumes of materials to process. And of course, there's the obvious additional material recovery and waste aversion that would result from this broader scope. The European Union found that once the infrastructure was developed in recycling e-waste in a responsible manner, that the processing costs came down, domestic competition increased, and recyclers actually began bidding against each other for end-of-life products. We've been operating in Europe for over 6 years now. We've just built our second world-class plant in Europe. We know the dynamics there very well, and they've gone from a very costly e-cycling operations to now one where recyclers are bidding for the raw materials because of this economies of scale advantages and the large-scale advantages. The key to reaping benefits of scale and competition is to increase the recycling volumes. Increasing the volumes for recycling also obviously increases the number of jobs created, the revenue and tax generation, and the energy and CO2 savings. The second policy we recommend is very important. The government needs to ensure that there's a fair and level playing field to encourage domestic recyclers to make significant capital investments. I know as a recycler, I will not make investments, and unfortunately, I haven't been able to make large investments here in California because I can't be guaranteed a source of incoming raw material. That's the only reason we don't have world-scale plants here in the state of California, the only reason. We often point to low labor costs as the reason manufacturing jobs move to developing countries. This is largely true for traditional manufacturing, but for recycling, the biggest costs are the capital investments and the important environmental health and safety protections we must have in place to operate in developed countries. Foreign downstream processors often work outside even local regulations. And I think some of the pictures in the written testimony that I provided and ones that you're probably more familiar with than I attest to the difference in standards in some developed countries on processing this waste than we're forced to have at our scale, our state-of-the-art plants around the world. Recyclers in the state of California should only be allowed to send their downstream materials to processors that meet reasonable environmental health and safety standards. This allows our processors to compete more fairly, and it also protects the ecosystems and people in developing countries. I think that's two very important reasons to keep track of where we send our downstream materials. Today we have something approaching what you might call free trade, but it's not fair trade. Finally, our third and last policy recommendation is about market pull. Manufacturers should be rewarded for using post-consumer recycled materials in their products through green procurement policies and incentives. Creating demand for post-consumer recycled materials allows manufacturers to justify the risk in trying out new materials and lowers the risk for recyclers to make capital investments because it creates markets for their products. This can start with state agencies, as the U.S. government has already done, but consumer-oriented incentives should also be considered. I'll point to EPEAT as one example of a standard that's been adopted by the U.S. government and has dramatically influenced the way manufacturers look at using recycled materials and also other attributes of their products. I think Doug knows the impact of that very well. Finally, we believe that these three simple policies would not only put California in a clean tech leadership position, it would create significant economic, material security, CO2 reduction, and energy savings benefits. I believe these are all priorities as for our state as and as for our country today. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Biddle. Now let's hear from Mr. Smith, Douglas Smith from Sony.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Doug Smith. I'm with the Director of Corporate Environmental Affairs for Sony Electronics. Sony is a manufacturer of TV, computer equipment, gaming equipment, and we are also a retailer. We have been active in the stakeholder process of bringing sustainable solutions to electronic waste management for more than 20 years. In 1990, CRT glass was routinely recycled from our San Diego factory. In 2007, Sony launched a comprehensive nationwide take-back program at no cost to the consumer, anything with the Sony brand name on it, be it a TV, PC, or PlayStation. And since launching nationwide in 2007, we've recycled over 20,000 tons of electronic waste in a responsible and environmentally friendly manner, with vendors being held to high standards. To further this commitment, Sony recently adopted the policy of requiring our vendors to obtain EPA's R2 certification or adopt the e-steward program. The sustainable model we are pursuing is where high-quality supply chains are set up to direct materials derived from electronic waste back to its point of origin. This is in the spirit of producer responsibility, and this also lowers costs to our customers. The proper oversight of take-back and recycling involves auditing of these third-party service providers. The purpose of the auditing is to reduce the risk associated with our decisions and actions, and this responsibility extends to electronic waste processors. The next phase of this improvement to our risk management process are these certification programs, which the certifiers are sufficiently independent and accredited by third-party auditing oversight organizations. Electronic waste is valuable, and the capture of metals is always the primary driving force. The average metal value contained in a pound of circuit board scrap has been reported to exceed $6 per pound, and it is common for an electronic product to have several pounds of circuit boards. The math is easy, and the appeal to obtain this in large quantities is powerful. Sony's belief is that this inherent value is and remains a sustainable driving force which will make electronics waste profitable even in the United States. However, there are proper, safe, efficient ways to recover, and there are improper, unsafe, and inefficient ways to recover this material. Along with the metals are components that the e-waste has. And these components can be salvaged, and they supply the worldwide repair industry. And this helps close the digital divide in developing nations. These countries are also the manufacturing centers that require dependable, high-quality raw materials to make new products from for worldwide distribution. It is not sustainable to force these countries to rely exclusively on raw materials extracted from the earth, when electronic waste is the richest ore of all possible choices for new raw materials. The carbon and pollution savings of recycling electronic waste compared to ore is 33 times favorable. The cost to a recycler to obtain certification can be significant. However, my experience with R2 certified vendors is that there is no cost increase when we require the R2 certification. The transparency and disclosure requirements are something new to recyclers. As a manufacturer, it's not new. Going back to the Form R TRI days, disclosure can actually be very beneficial to the company. I would just caution some disclosures, if they touch on business confidential information, you know, should be that's the grounds that, you know, a lot of these companies compete on. Certifications that are all overly focused on red tape will create a de facto prohibition on recovery of components, and which enables shredding to be the least cost option. So in other words, we don't want shredding could become the low cost, most favorable option if there's too much red tape associated with salvaging components for resale. I would also like to point out the California system is the single most effective method of controlling exports from the United States and California. The act of canceling each device in California has created jobs and many recycling jobs. No other state EPR, Extended Producer Responsibility Program, has such an advanced program. In my opinion, it's a reflection of the genius of Representative Byron Scher and his staff to have vetted thousands of variables and came up with a sustainable program because it's fair in the market and it hasn't impacted our sales. I would say extended producer responsibility in the other states is nothing short of a disaster. It is an egregious use of the English language to suggest there's any responsibility under the EPR programs. All we are is paying for waste collection. As was mentioned earlier, the bulk of the cost is associated with collection. There's no such thing as us being able to design a product to lower the cost of collecting a pound. A pound is a pound. It's always going to be a pound. But in most of the EPR states, we're paying for collection. Also, the internalization of this cost into our sales price has the effect of you've got states such as Mississippi below the average, progressive
poverty line.
Yeah, something like that. Paying for richer states like New York, Washington. In a progressive taxation sense, since this is a public service and it's typically we're funding community collection, this is anti-progressive as far as taxation goes. So California residents pay a fee when they buy a product, and that money stays in California. But also, you're paying for the program in Washington, you're paying for the program in New York, you're paying for it in Connecticut, you're paying all these other states because the cost is buried in at the point of manufacturing. And I would be absolutely in favor of, if we were able to control this and get our material back, sure, we can pay for the whole thing, but the way it is, as long as we're paying for collection, there is always going to be this incredible unfairness in the marketplace. And I'll just say the only real pathway to fairness is a national legislation if we're going to go the EPR route. Otherwise, what California has is far head and shoulders. You heard the billion pounds collected here. It's phenomenal what's done here. Like I say, as a manufacturer, it hasn't impacted our sales. And as a retailer, it hasn't impacted our retail operations. Sony remains an engaged stakeholder in the pursuit of bringing sustainable solutions where economic and environmental interests are balanced to bring a high-quality service to our customers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Assemblymember Brownlee.
I know we're rushed, so I'll try to be quick. I had a question for Mr. Biddle. In your business, and maybe you mentioned it and I missed it, but is what percentage is e-waste and what is auto?
We do both, but our plant in Austria and our plant in China, Guangzhou, China, are both 100% e-waste. Our plant that we've just opened in the UK, which is our largest yet, handles about 200 million pounds a year input, is a mixture of e-waste and automobiles.
And what about here in California?
Well, here in California, we do very little production because I can't get my hands on it. Either it's not collected or it finds its way overseas before I can get my hands on the majority of it. We actually do some processing from two processors here in California, but that's it.
So in the rest of the world or where you're doing business, the products get recycled, the toxic products go someplace.
Correct.
We
have to dispose of those responsibly. We separate.
So you dispose of those.
Correct. The materials containing
so you're
either
collecting
heavy metals
and
bromated
separating out and then taking the plastic in.
That's correct. And we're held to high standards by by end of users like Sony, that we have to prove that all of those toxins have been taken out at least below the Ross and Reach limits.
So they're not recyclers out there separating out, and then you're just getting the plastic product for your business. You're doing all of that yourself.
Well, what we get is a predominantly plastic-rich mixed stream, but it has metals, some residue circuit boards that were missed by the metal recyclers, rubber, foam, wood, glass, dirt, you name it.
Yeah.
It's everything that left over after the metals are recovered, basically, is our feed.
Thank you.
Other members. Well, thank you, gentlemen. We'll move on to our final panel, which is the industry panel. We have with us today on the e-waste recycling, John Segarian, who's the co-founder and chairman and CEO of Electronics Recyclers, ERA LLC. We have Dennis Kazarian, who's the vice president at e-recycling of California. And we have Renee St. Dennis is the Vice President of Business Development for Sims Recycling Solution. I thank each and every one of you for being with us this this morning. Mr. Segarian, please begin.
Well, thank you very much for having me here today. I'm the CEO and Chairman of Electronic Recyclers International. We're the leading e-waste company in California since the inception of SB 20/50 in 2005. A couple of preambles that I want to just share here. I'm honored and privileged to be here. All the speakers that you've invited are the best of the best in the industry. Let me just tell you that. That's the only thing I could say for sure in terms of this testimony. Mark Murray, Sheila Davis, Jeff Hunts, the DTSC, the Integrated Waste Management Board, we have the best system in the nation, bar none, in California. Almost 1 billion pounds recycled. You could take the five biggest states in this nation and add up everything they've recycled with regards to electronic waste to date in the same time period. It wouldn't equal what we've recycled here in the state of California. So, yes, is it an imperfect program? Sure. It's a brand new industry. But are we the best to date in the nation? Absolutely, we are the best. And I thank all the people that have made it the best to date. Under Jeff Hunt's leadership with the Integrated Waste Management Board and the DTSC, and with Mark Murray's and Sheila Davis's input, we are really truly the world leader. Since our inception, Electronic Recyclers International, we have the highest compliance ratio in the state of California, a 97% compliance rate since its inception, since 2005. In the last 12 months, we're 99% compliant. Nobody in baseball or in any other sport has that kind of batting average. So we're proud of what we take this industry very seriously. We take what we do very seriously. This is a serious issue, both for environmental health and safety purposes, and the environment that we are so proud of here in California, and the fact that we are proud that we are the leaders in environmental issues in the state of California. What have we done to further the cause? We invested millions of dollars in research and development. We built the largest electronic waste shredding facility in the world in Fresno, California. People have come from all countries, Europe, Asia, and all across America, all of our clients, the OEMs, and we represent over 40 OEMs as clients, retailers, and smelters have come from around the world to see this shredder. So we're very proud that we have built the leading electronic waste shredding facility in the world. We're building two more of those in other states right now. And we have seven locations in six states nationally. So we have a great perspective on the California law, given that we understand and we operate in every other state in this nation. Two or three other things we've done. We've taken on an investment partner, and we're the only recycler in the world in the electronic waste industry to have a downstream investment partner. LS Nikko Copper is our investment partner. That's the world-renowned Koo family from Korea, who are the founders of LG Electronics, which they still own and control. LS Nikko Copper is the third largest copper smelter in the world, and they therefore get all of our printed circuit boards, our precious metals, copper, and all the other materials. So our transparency for our downstream vendors is second to none. Lastly, glass, as has been already described, so I'm not going to go into it that much further, is one of the critical flashpoints of this industry and continues to be. We, again, spent millions of dollars traveling and researching and developing the best glass technologies. What we found is the best glass technology for cleaning glass came out of Europe and Japan, and we licensed that proprietary technology, which is right now being used in over 20 recyclers in Japan and Europe, and we brought it to California and installed it in Fresno. So we therefore clean our own glass and ship it directly to smelters across the world. Again, increasing transparency and collapsing the chain, the supply chain, and getting everybody out of the middle. That's very important. People said that would never be done here in California, but we were proud to do it. And there's only one other recycler who's sitting on this panel with me that's actually installed their own glass cleaning technology in the state of California. I therefore would like to invite any and all of you, knowing that resources are limited, and or your staffers, to come a mere 2.5 hours to Fresno and see what we've built underneath roof. Because as we evolve as a state, and as you thankfully are reviewing how to evolve the laws to keep up with the times, as was pointed out by Mr. Chesbro earlier, when this law was enacted, there was no such thing as a Kindle, an iPhone. By the way, there was no such thing as 3D television. The laws now need to be kept more up to date with what is going on. So I invite you all or your staffers to come at any time and see what we are doing. And we are the leading brand in the state. A couple other points. We also signed up for, as Sheila Davis pointed out earlier, the Great eSteward program and also the R2 program. Most great or good recyclers have signed up for either or. We have signed up for both and are going through the process of getting certified under both great standards. Again, something that the state has encouraged, and I encourage in further and how you evolve the laws to require further certifications of either the R2 or BAND standard, if not both, of your better recyclers that are going to participate and have the privilege to participate under the SB 20/50/whatever-you-expand-it-to program. I don't want to take up much more time because I want to leave this open for questions, and I also want to share the platform with the great brands that are sitting next to me, both Sims and Dennis Kazarian's brand, E-Recycling, both which are run very well and are my friendly competitors here in the state of California. But I do have to make clear a couple of last points. We agree with the suggestions that were made earlier today. We are an imperfect program, but we are the best in the nation, and we can make this better if we all collaborate on our information together. We should increase all the electronics covered in the future. We should increase the transparency and tracking of all the commodities. We should increase enforcement, which isn't as hard as everybody thinks it is. We should also increase and expand the glass options that exist, because the glass options, since this industry was created here in California, have shrunk measurably. And we should also impress upon the better recyclers who are going to have the privilege to participate on this program that they should get either BAND certified or R2 certified or both. And I thank you for inviting me today here, and I'll take any questions after my co-colleagues here are done testimony.
Thank you. Mr. Kazarian, please proceed.
Thank you, Johnny. Johnny is my friend and competitor, and I welcome the offer to take a tour of his facility. Thank you, Johnny.
Anytime for a fellow Armenian.
And I'm from Fresno, so thank you. My name's Dennis Kazarian, and I'm Vice President of E-Recycling of California. I'll give you a quick background of ourselves. It's a family business. Owned only by our family. We started in 1934, and we're in the refuse industry. We own Calmet Services, which is a refuse company. We also own Tierra Verde, which is an 80-acre composting facility on the Great Parks in Orange County. We have a med waste service called Medical Waste Services, which we do medical waste, and we have a transfer station. Our family motto is, your trash is our cash, as you can imagine. So we come from that whole source, and electronic recycling was just a natural process of what we do. We have three facilities at E-Recycling. We have one in Paramount, California, one in Orange County, and one in Hayward, California. So we cover the state. This is a business that we started prior to any SB 20 or SB 50. We were in this business right from the beginning. It was banned from the landfill by DTSC. We had to pull it out of our refuse trucks. We had to pull it out of our transfer station, and we said, there's something here. We need to do something with it, and we figured out what to do with it. We took it apart. We started to see the commodities. We began to realize the glass issue and dealt with the glass. We were there right from the beginning. Mm-hmm. As the process went on, we started by taking care of the haulers. Up and down the state, they're our friends, and we went up and down the state and met with them and said, you're going to have a problem. Let us help you. And they did. We started that process, and we started to take care of that. The cities and the counties, especially the landfills, we started that process to help them out. And we built individual racks for them. We serviced them, and they were paying. It was the cities and counties who saw the problem financially, because they all of a sudden said, oh, this is a cost to us. They had roundups. People came to those roundups and dropped that material off. And the cities and counties were incurring that cost. Mm-hmm. They came to the legislature and said, how are we going to solve this problem? How are we going to address this only a growing problem? They got this program in place, which has been a good program, but it has some, it went sideways in some senses. The cost was to take care of us to recycle the material, and then there was a fee added to take care of what was called a collector, those who were collecting it, the cities and presumably the counties, what they thought would be locations that people would drop off that material, and they would pay them something, the state would pay them something out of that fund to help with the collection, which in turn they would give to us and give us a fee. We became the enforcement and the banker for this program. Mm-hmm. Because as material came in, and as because collectors came in, collectors became not just cities and counties, but became charities, became the school districts, became other vendors, became people, and then they became a whole class of what we call handlers, who didn't register as collectors. Mm-hmm. They just started to pick up this material. They went around and created a business. They created a good business, but one that caused us enormous problems, because when they collected it, they had to produce a name and address of where they picked that material up, or else we couldn't get paid. And so when they brought that material to us, we had to verify it. We became the police enforcement, because we had to take that material, we had to check it, and it increased our staff mm-hmm. immensely, because prior to SB 20, we just got paid because we charged the county. We charged individuals, and they were bringing it in. And now we had documentation. Rightfully so. We needed documentation because we should only be paying for California material. So we created that scenario. We became the policemen, and we hired people to check. We still found people messing with us. We still found false information coming in. We still found that to be difficult. And equally important, we became the banker for the state of California. Because by the time we took our documentation and gave it to the state to verify, you're probably looking at a minimum of 90 days, if not 120. Sometimes longer, but that's the natural standard process. We understand that, but we fronted that money. Because we paid that collector. Because that collector came to us and said, geez, you don't want to pay me? Well, I'm going to go to my friend Johnny, or I'm going to go to Sims. And then it became a bidding war. Then they got smart and said, well, geez, you know, how much are you willing to pay me? We said, well, you're only supposed to get this much. This is what the state's mandated for you. Well, no, you're getting the money. You get the whole money. You've got to give me that, and I want some more. And later in the process, when e-waste came up and the state banned e-waste or DTSC banned e-waste in February of 2008, other material not covered, we didn't know what to do with it. We weren't prepared for that material. We were handling ourselves and taking care of the glass. They came to us and said, well, you know this new waste? Geez, you better take that. Well, I don't want it. There's a cost to that. I don't deal with that stuff. No. You take it or we're going to take our material somewhere else. That's how we got affected. But in addition, the industry saw that there were those who were selling material overseas. We break down our material. We don't do refurbishing. Not that that's not a good thing. We don't do reuse. E-recycling is an end of life. It breaks down every unit. As Johnny said, we have a shredder. We have a copper chopper. You can see the wire go through, and you can see the copper go here and the insulation go here. We have different machines. I have 150 guys on the line taking everything apart. Okay? We have a shredder. We have the first glass cleaning machine where we clean that glass, take the phosphorus off, mechanical abrasion, and we could send that material anywhere because it's technically clean glass and a new product. I will tell you this, that contrary to what anybody's going to tell you today about waste going overseas or the amounts of material being taken out illegally, if it wasn't for this system in California, as with all the inequities and all the problems in it, California would be the leading exporter of illegal waste in the world. This system has worked. It's worked better than any other system, any other state. It has driven not only us to create jobs, but it has driven the consumer to have a place to move this material and get it done legally and environmentally safe.
Thank you. Ms. Dennis, we have a few more minutes.
Yeah.
If you could give us the highlights of your testimony.
I'll try. Okay. So I just first of all want to thank Chairman Wachowski and Chairman Chesbro for inviting me here and the members of the committee. My name is Renee St. Dennis. I'm a vice president at Sims Recycling Solutions. Sims Recycling Solutions is a division of Sims Metal Management, which is the largest metals recycler in the world. And as it turns out, Sims Recycling Solutions is the largest electronics recycler in the world. We have over 40 locations around the world. We have 15 locations in North America, three of them here in California. Sims is a publicly traded $13 billion company, and we were just recently named to the Global 100 Most Sustainable Companies in the World at the World Economic Forum for the third year in a row, much like Mr. Biddle, so we're very proud of that. We're also proud of our record of safety and innovation. And I'm a little disappointed to say that I'm coming here with a slightly different point of view than my colleagues on the panel. We have gone from being one of the largest processors and participants in the SB 50 program to a very small participant. And that we've done that because we need to have more control over the material that comes into us, what type of material, and who it comes from. As both my colleagues have pointed out and others have talked to you on this panel, the amount of administrative oversight required to participate in this program and not have your claims be at risk of being denied is astounding. Sims participates in systems all over the country and all over the world. This is by far the most administratively heavy program we participate in. In addition, unfair competition from illegal export of uncovered waste electronics makes participation in the SB 50 program virtually impossible for a professional recycling company which has with sensible pension and health benefits and also the kind of stringent safety and environmental controls and procedures that Sims has. It seems a shame to me that from its goal of leading the U.S., California's covered electronic waste system is now one which inhibits innovation in electronics recycling, discourages investment in recycling, in new technologies, and acts as a conduit for the uncontrolled export of hundreds of millions of pounds of uncovered electronics waste to developing countries around the world. There are three issues, most of which you've heard about today. I just want to put a quick spin on them. So the first one is the glass issue itself. What's going to happen to it? Where is it going to go? I was the source of that story about glass being put in a roadbed in the Netherlands, where, by the way, most roads are under sea level. There have been studies done there. They're not just doing this without studying what's happening. Not to say that it's necessarily what we want to do here in California, but their regulatory system is open to those kinds of new uses for this material. It's important to note that California's regulations require that both the leaded and the unleaded glass being 65% of the glass that's produced in these processes, actually be treated as hazardous because there's no effective way to get them entirely clean of the lead dust and the barium that might be in the glass itself as it's processed. Secondly, the export of uncovered waste electronic devices provides exporters with an unfair cost advantage. In California, we have this dichotomous situation where we have a ban on landfilling any waste electronics, but no formal recycling mechanism for the vast majority of them, those being those without a display device. We're therefore left in a situation whereby the uncovered electronic devices are collected alongside the DEWs. You've heard that over and over today. Unfortunately, that means that collection is at least partly, and in many cases wholly, cross-funded by the CEW collector program. That is not the intention of this bill. It's created an incentive for uncontrolled export of electronic waste to Asia and other developing economies. And again, this export has been effectively paid for by the SB 50 program. Finally, the SB 50 program is flawed by creating a legislative solution to electronics waste that does not include the manufacturers of these products. In every other state, and indeed in every other region around the world, producer responsibility is the norm and accepted practice. The manufacturers who contract with Sims in all these other parts of the world and in other parts of the U.S. Have standards and auditing protocols which exceed regulatory requirements and even the requirements of the certifications that you've heard about today. As a result of their involvement, the bar on recycling continues to be raised, and it's the manufacturers that have driven that. The system is governed by market mechanisms, not by government intervention. These issues push a company like Sims, and in fact Sims, to locate new facilities in other parts of North America. In fact, we opened two sites in the last 6 months, one in Edison, New Jersey, the other in Mississauga, Ontario, with a combined investment of over $20 million to get these sites up and running. Additional investments are going to be in parts of North America that reward such investment, and often that reward is tied to a producer responsibility system where, again, we have predictable flows of material, predicted payment schemes, and predictable contractual arrangements. So finally, you know, what can we do here? I think the most important thing it would be the development of a producer responsibility system that clearly defines the standards and practices for environmentally sound recycling. That will encourage proper handling of this material rather than wholesale export to developing economies. Thanks.
Thank you for your comments. Chair Wesley?
I just wish that we weren't doing the floor 2 minutes ago, because I'd love to have a half an hour or an hour to sort through the differences in perspective and try to get a handle on it, because clearly there are different experiences from the different companies. And in terms of moving forward, we need to have a better handle on it. So I don't know quite how we can, with the time frame we have here, get a discussion like that going.
We do have a hearing next week, Tuesday, I believe, on producer responsibility. So at least get a portion of it. Unfortunately, this is a public hearing, so I'm going to have to open it up for public testimony. I agree that it would be, unless you have a specific question.
My only other comment would be, to the extent that any of you are in Sacramento or you want to write something down, it'd be probably the easiest for you to write it down so that you could circulate it to members and not just, you know, have to have eight visits here. But I think I'm very fascinated and interested in both sides of the discussion. So rebutting each other's welcome, because I think we really do need to get an understanding of how it works from the standpoint of this important industry to the future of our state and to capture the maximum economic benefit, not just address the environmental problems that we've heard about today.
Those are topics that need to be discussed.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's what we're looking at. Yeah. I'll be discussing with Chair Chesbrough about putting together a working group on these e-waste issues and where we can go forward. We do have legislation. I have an omnibus bill on this, and we have, as somebody alluded to, Representative Lowenthal's bill. Are there members of the public who would like to come forward? Unfortunately, I'm going to ask that you limit your statements to 1 minute, since we're already supposed to be on the floor. I'm not used to starting a meeting in the morning, so normally afternoon we can go a couple of minutes. Seeing none, I want to thank everybody for all the participants this morning and joining us, and the members that were here, and we are adjourned.